Hello, this is Gonzalo Lira speaking to you live, and this is the Roundtable, episode number 13. And it is a real pleasure to welcome two people whom I've gotten to know as of late, who are just absolutely lovely. And we're going to be talking about some very interesting things insofar as sanctions, how the sanctions have backfired, and how the Dutch farmers in particular are protesting, and all kinds of interesting things insofar as the reaction to the sanctions. So with me today is Joost Niemöller. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, Joost.
Yeah, okay. It's okay. Actually, it's Joost, but everybody calls me Joost, and so that's fine.
Oh, please, tell us the correct pronunciation so that we know.
Well, it's very, maybe not for you, but it's Joost, with double O.
Yeah?
No. Okay. But Joost is okay. I don't.
Joost. I'm so sorry. Joost Niemöller, he is a dissident journalist. He is a canceled journalist, and we'll talk about how he was canceled. That sounds very interesting. And mm-hmm. So, Joost, thank you so much for coming on. It's a real pleasure to have you here.
Yeah, same to me.
And there's Fiorella Isabel, who is a journalist, and now she is in Moscow. She is starving to death because of the sanctions, because there's no food, and the people are just scavenging for food wheresoever they can in Moscow. And don't be fooled by the very nice apartment that I see behind you. That's your place, by the way?
Yeah. This is my film room.
Yeah, it's really lovely. Thank you so much for being on. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
You know, my pleasure. So tell me about the life in Moscow under the regime of the sanctions.
Right. So I came to Moscow and I wasn't expecting it to be what the West has said, that everything is falling apart, that people are still in breadlines, that they picture it like the USSR, like they still have this idea. A lot of people think, you know, Putin is a crazy communist. That's what I mean. A lot of people are just so misinformed, especially in the West, about what Russia is. And I come and the subways, the metro is beautiful. It's like a museum. There is literally no trash in the streets. There's no homelessness. Everything is very efficient. From the moment I got to the airport, to the moment I used public transportation, to just the way things are done. Now, there is a lot of bureaucracy, which is part of the Soviet era. But in terms of like the cleanliness and the efficiency and the restaurants and just like the plethora of life in the streets, people walking, people going on picnics, enjoying the summer because they know winter is coming. But winter is coming more so for the EU than it is for Russia, because here, I think in September, automatically the gas switches on and it's very, very cheap. And you just have heating everywhere. In Europe, they're already telling people to scavenge for firewood or take cold showers. So, I mean, right now, I see a lot of people I know sort of moving over here. And I find that really interesting because these sanctions are not hurting Russians. In fact, the sanctions hurt me the most when I came here, and it hurt several of my colleagues, because I thought that I could at least use some of my cards because I was told MasterCard and Visa worked, but they only work for the Russian type of cards, yeah. Not for us. So I wasn't able to use any of my cards, and luckily I had cash. And I tell people, like, you have to bring enough cash, because until you have a bank card, you can't do anything here. And it's not the Russians doing this, it's the United States' sanctions. And it's just, that's been the hardest part, is figuring out how to get money into my American bank accounts or vice versa. And other than that, like, if you, once you live here and you have a bank card and you have things situated, it's very nice, I have to say. It's honestly, I mean, just compared to a New York City subway station where there's rats, there's just complete poverty, to Moscow, it's night and day.
Yeah, well, Moscow is famous for its subways. I mean, and that's one of the things that everybody's been saying for decades, that they're the most beautiful. And I've seen pictures. I've never been there myself. I can say also that Kharkov, here in Ukraine, the subways are each very different and distinct. Some of them are very pretty. Some of them are a little dull, perhaps, but there's an effort. An effort was made, and it's light years from the New York subway. But the thing I'm curious about is, you know, how is the day-to-day living insofar as sanctions are concerned in Moscow? I mean, do you see any effect whatsoever in your day-to-day, in food shopping, in any aspect whatsoever?
Not really. I mean, if you're a person that had like an independent business or if you had a lot of merchandise that was, you know, American, it could be a problem in terms of like retail, like Victoria's Secret left, H&M, Zara, a lot of things that a lot of people here like to shop at. They're like, oh, I can't get it anymore. But that's actually opened up the opportunity for Russian brands. This is like kind of funny, like that I started learning about this, like Russian makeup, Korean makeup, Korean beauty products, like independent, small Russian, like retail people have a chance now. So that's opening up for those people, because the corporate American brands are harder to come by. Yes, some people miss them, but that's only if you're looking for that sort of thing. As far as what you need, you can go to the grocery store, the shelves are full. They don't have a shortage of baby formula. There's so many different things that you can get. I mean, I do think like Moscow is definitely not, it's not a super cheap city, and it's not like super expensive either. It's like right there. And things have gone up in price for Americans because our dollar has sunk, right? Yeah. So like it's good for Russians, but let's say you're getting paid in American dollars, it's not as great because the dollar has dipped down. So that's more of the issue. Like I said, that's affecting the Americans perhaps living in Russia, or the foreigners, maybe people from the EU coming here, more than it is affecting the Russians themselves. And you just see, again, people taking taxis, people taking the metro, people walking, people going out and spending money in bars. People just, you can go find like just clean, nice grocery stores. And there's just the delivery aspect too. The food delivery here is so quick and efficient. And the day-to-day life here isn't difficult. I think the most difficult thing for someone like me who thinks it's cold when it's below 60 is going to be that. It's going to be that. But other than that, like I just find life here very simple, very efficient, and people are actually nice. You know, Russians have this reputation of being very, you know, just cold or mean. And the American and the British way of being is, especially the American, I would say, I'm going to speak for Americans. It's just very overtly friendly. You're told to, if you work in hospitality, to be smiley. And that is, I mean, the service industry is unique in the United States because people don't make a wage. They literally get paid on tips. So yeah. It's just like, so here it's a little bit different. You know, the way people are is more upfront and more just honest. There's less of a formality. And I can appreciate that as somebody that actually likes that over a lot of the formalities, but that's just me personally. Yeah. But
It's a lot easier to deal with somebody if they're upfront and you know exactly where you stand with them. In the United States, the passive aggressive, kind of like always smiling and trying to be friendly, you never know where you're standing with them. They might hate you and you'll never know.
That's exactly it. Yes, that's totally it.
a question I have about the mentality, or not the mentality, the effects of the special military operation or war or invasion or however you want to call it. Is it affecting the day-to-day life of people in Russia?
No. I mean, the only thing I've seen, and this is, you know, this may surprise some people in the West who think that everybody here loves Putin. They don't. A lot of people don't like him. Even people that I work with in a pro-Russian, supposedly a Russia state-affiliated media, don't necessarily all love the government. In fact, they ask me, why are you here right now? What are you doing? Like, this is like, they've asked, you know, our colleagues who are also from the States, like, what made you come here? But the thing is, a lot of people understand the geopolitics. They understand why things are happening. They understand what the U.S. has done. In the United States, it's the opposite. People don't understand anything of what's happening. People don't understand what's going on. And so that reality is completely different. And I think the thing that I've noticed most here from people who are Russian is that they hate this conflict or war. Some of them call it war, some of them call it a conflict. I see it as more of a conflict, but they hate that this is happening because a lot of them have family members, a lot of them have friends, a lot of them would go into Ukraine. They see the Ukrainian people as brothers and sisters. They don't see them as enemies. They don't want to continue this. I mean, they loved having been able to travel to Crimea. They loved having to travel to Ukraine and being able to travel to Europe. A lot of people here still hold a positive view about the West. They still think that the United States is this positive place in general. And that's more so culturally what they see in movies and music. They love American music. I've been karaokeing with Russians. It's hilarious. I think they just love this American like type of, you know, art. And it's really interesting. You don't see the hatred for Americans. You don't see the hatred for Ukrainians, but you also don't see people being directly affected here, which is something that I think Ukrainians will point out and say, see, well, that's, you're lucky because Russians aren't being, you know, shelled, but, you know, they're forgetting about what's going on in the Donbass and what's been going on for the last 8 years. And so that is something that I'd like to point out, is a lot of people here are very, very much, they have so much love for the people of Ukraine, and there's not hate for Americans. There's more of curiosity and intrigue and like, oh, wow, this is America. You know, they're still fascinated in a way by mm-hmm. the West.
So, okay. I mean, this is really a good and very complete picture that you're painting. Now, the issue of the sanctions, of course, is that they were designed to hurt the Russians, and they haven't hurt the Russians. Instead, they've hurt the Europeans. And here I want to bring in Joost, who can tell us how the sanctions are hurting the Europeans and how the Europeans seem to be shooting themselves in the foot. Or somebody, I forget who it was, said that it's really that the Europeans are shooting themselves through the lungs. You know, very, very grotesque imagery. I forget, some Hungarian foreign minister, I might have said that. It slips my mind who, but it was a famous saying. Mm-hmm. Just, you're in the Netherlands. And the reason I wanted to bring you on is I wanted you to fill us in about the whole issue of the farmers' protests. Because as far as I can tell, and Fiorella, correct me if I'm wrong, nobody in the West is covering the massive work stoppages and protests of the farmers. And I want to know what's going on and why aren't they being, you know, why isn't this more bigger news in the West? Joost, please, what has happened?
Yeah. Well, it's. I was thinking, is there some relation with what we talked about before with Russia and with the farmers? I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. I think those things are related in a way. But
basically what's going on is that the farmers are on strike, you know, and they're protesting. Against
well, they're
the
not
government.
Striking because they cannot strike because they're business. So then the strike, they hurt themselves. So the only thing they can do is go on the road with the tractors and do all kinds of actions against the government. And they are very... most of the Dutch people are in favor of them, so they're not against the Dutch people or something, but they are against the government at the moment. Mm-hmm. That's what's happening at the moment. But the situation in the Netherlands is because the sanction also getting bad and getting worse, especially when winter comes, but also because the inflation is huge at the moment, so it's getting more and more a problem of the people who are more or less on the poor side of the society. The prices in the shops went up for 20%. Mm-hmm. That's enormous when you are. It's difficult to pay your bill at the end of the month, and you cannot. So that's one of the problems we do have here. With the farmers, it's also this problem that they don't get much for the product they made. And that costs mm-hmm. even worse. So there's also a relationship between that. But what you see here is that it looks like more or less a perfect storm. All kinds of things are coming together, which don't have anything to do with each other. And that's what's going on. So we see here a plan about the reason why the farmers are so upset is because there was a plan of the government saying nitrogen is a problem because of the nature. So they have a big plan of how much nature, official nature, we would have to have, and the farmers were the problem for that. So we have to get lost of half of the farmers in the Netherlands, and they make a map, and on the map you could see all the farmers which has lost their farm. So they saw the map and they were already angry.
Basically, the government basically published a map saying these farms are going to be expropriated, or they're not going to be allowed to farm, or what was?
So they just say these farms has to sell their farms, has to sell their land to the government,
at a fair price or at a below market value.
Well, I mean, they don't have much choice, don't they? There's only one buyer, and that's the government.
Yeah. But I mean, like, look, I lived in the Netherlands for almost 2 years. I lived in Amsterdam, and the Dutch are salt of the earth people. And what I noticed was that there was a great deal of cooperation between the Dutch. And it seemed that they had a very strong relationship with their government, in the sense that the government was responsive to their needs. Why is it that all of a sudden the government seems to be turning its back on its farmers, especially considering that farming is such an important business in the Netherlands? What happened?
Well, that's a very good question. And this is also to do with what's behind the war in Ukraine, because what you see here is this whole movement towards more globalization, which is actually a movement toward more American influence, and they make it look like it's international, but in fact it's all American power behind it. So you have all these organizations like the World Economic Forum, the endless amount of organizations, and they called it freedom, and they called it international, and they are working against, on an international scale, against some of the other big countries which are organizing themselves now, like Russia and China and Brazil, like in the BRIC countries. And now you see for the first time, and India also, and now you see for the first time that those countries, they don't look at America anymore as their friend. They look as kind of opposition to them. And I don't see American as international freedom anymore. And this globalization, this effect of globalization, is also an effect on the farmers, because of this globalization, you get more migration, you get more people in the. I'm sorry, but everything has to do with everything. So it's very complex to say. Everything is connected. So, because of the mass immigration, lots of people go to the Netherlands. Oh, it's already full, but it's getting more full every year. Every year, there are more, maybe 1 million extra people coming. Well, that's maybe a bit too much, but in that account, lots of Dutch people are moving away. So you see a change of the people in the Netherlands. And also, you see a need for land, and you see a need for where to build new houses. And so you see that a lot of the land in the Netherlands is still owned by the farmers. And there are not so many farmers anymore, because everything is, you know, they don't need many people anymore to do it. And they produce enormous amount of food all the time. So they look at it and say, look, we have a lot of empty land, which is not official nature. So there are not many people, and they're not very good organized anymore. So let's take over the land. I mean, that's what the hidden agenda behind it is. And put more people in it so we can build more houses.
So it's basically a land development swindle that the government is perpetrating on the farmers.
Right. And when you say things like that, they say, well, you're making these things up, because we never say this officially, et cetera, et cetera. But a lot of people, and also the farmers, they know that this exactly is what behind this. And the same thing is...
By the way, Joost, I heard this... it sounded crazy to me, so I'll tell you what it is and why it sounds crazy to me, and you tell me if this is accurate or not. There's this crazy idea that what they want to do is that the globalists, call them what you will, want to create a giant megalopolis like across the Netherlands and Belgium and turn it all into housing.
Right. That's the the plan is called a triad state. It's a plan. I mean, it's not an official government plan, but it's a plan that they say, and it's going in that direction because everybody knows that. So it will be the end of the Netherlands. It will be the end of Belgium and Germany as we know it. And when you look at the famous map from the universe, you look to Europe at night and you see there's a bulb of light somewhere, and that's exactly where this place is. So that is the Netherlands, the west of Belgium, and the western part, North Rhine-Westphalia, and the western part of Germany. And in this part is the most industrialized, urbanized area of whole of Europe. Mm-hmm. And there are almost like, say, 30 million people living there. And those people who came up with this plan, they say, well, we have to go in competition with the real big cities in the world, like Shanghai. And I think Shanghai has something like 20 million people or something. Mm-hmm. So the Netherlands is too little. We have to work together and to make one city, one enormous city. And they call it Tri-State, but maybe a better name is Eurocity or something, the biggest city of Europe. And then go in competition with the world and be one of this whole globalized world. But what you see then is only people with a city-like mentality will stay there. There will be no conservative farmers or Christian farmers. I mean, they will all go away because there's no place for them. And it will all be kind of woke universum of city-like people. And that's exactly what is actually going on. I mean, it doesn't mean that there's a secret person behind having that plan and say, well, we're going for that. But all the minds on the people with power are going in that direction. So that's why this tri-state is a good example of what's going on.
Because it's not like, because when I hear a conspiracy, I always tune out.
Yeah.
Because I don't believe in conspiracies. I think that many people might go in the same direction because it benefits them for different reasons. And so they might all get on board with a particular policy. You're of the opinion that that's the same thing, that different groups in the European bureaucracy and the European financial centers, they want this because they can get more power, more money, more prestige, more whatever because of this? Is that your opinion?
People do live. I mean, that's the nature of people. They do live in bubbles. I mean, when you are in this Western, I would say woke bubble, international globalist woke bubble, you think different than when you are living in. Well, maybe not when you're living in Moscow, but when you're living in somewhere outside of Moscow or you're living in Africa in a little place, then you have a different way of thinking, and you need this. You need to do the same way of thinking to get into power, because other people think, oh, okay, I understand what you're thinking, and I will help you going along. And that's exactly what is going wrong now, because everybody in the Western world, in my idea, do have the idea that everybody else is also thinking on the same way. So they also think people in Russia and China and India and Brazil, they're all kind of Western individual kind of people, and they all want the same democracy, etc. But those societies are organized in a very different way. They have their own history, and that is at this moment the big thing which is going on in the world, that, and this is also what's going on now here in Ukraine, for example.
And so you think that what's going on is that the Western intelligentsia, the Western leadership class, is in such a bubble that it doesn't realize what it's doing and hurting the rest of the population?
Yeah, exactly.
So that's Fiorella, let me bring in Fiorella on this particular issue. Is this kind of atomization, this bubble living, are you seeing that in Russia, or is there more, like, to put it, I don't know quite how to put it, transverse communication between the different groups in Russia? Because this is something that we've all discussed, that in the West, every group is atomized and the leadership class is completely detached from the reality on the ground. Do you see something similar in Russia? Or if not, why not? What's the difference, as you see it at least?
Can I ask one question?
Sure.
It has to do with this, because you talked a lot about Moscow. But is there a big difference, in your opinion, between Moscow and the rest of Russia? In a way,
in my opinion?
Yep. Yeah, please.
Yeah. Yeah. There absolutely is. I mean, I've been to St. Petersburg, and I intend to travel more to the rest of the country. But there is definitely a big difference, and that's coming from a lot of Russians themselves. Like, Moscow is the power. The issue many have with Russia is that power is concentrated in Moscow, right? There's not enough of everything out in other cities. Now, they do have other cities that have, that are industrialized and have a lot of things, but they would like some more decentralization in terms of more equity for other cities. A lot of the outer cities tend to be more pro-Russian, though. Like, a lot of the people that live in other cities and tend to be more, from what I've been told, anti-Western, because they understand more the consequences of what the West has been doing to Russia, how they've been vilifying Russia and smearing Russia. Actually, Moscow is the most, I think I would say, but pro-Western city, besides St. Petersburg. There's a lot of, you know, cultural, artistic elements there as well. But Moscow is a very capitalist city. It's a very, it's a city that it wants technology, wants modernization. And so but the people here understand they understand the geopolitics of everything way more than the people in the United States, right? They understand the differences. People here have friends who are communists. They have friends who are not communists, and they're friends, and it affects them, but they not to the point that it affects us in the United States. For example, with the Trump versus Biden contingent in the United States, everything is extremely divided in the United States. Whereas here, yeah, it seems like people can more so live and have these differences and almost kind of make fun of it and just go on about their life. The youth is a lot more pro-West than the older population. They who a lot of times has a very nostalgic look over how things used to be. And that is just what I've observed and what I've been told from talking to actual Russians living here as well. And one of the things also that I wanted to point out is that Moscow itself is just extremely, not, like you said, it's just one area of Russia. It's not a total representation of it. And I think that, you know, when we talk about that, that has to be put out there as well, because it is always a lot of capital cities or a lot of cities that have so much industrialization do tend to be a certain way compared to the outside of it. And I think that's an important element to point out.
Yeah, because I looked it up just now. I had no idea about this figure, that Moscow has just shy of 12 million inhabitants, which is roughly 8-9% of the total Russian population. So it's a big chunk. And so, of course, it's the center of gravity. And, you know, I've been reading 19th century Russian novelists since I was a kid. And they all complain that, oh, there's too much power in Moscow. You know, they don't pay attention to the provinces. And this is a perennial complaint. And I come from Chile, and, you know, Santiago is the major city, and we have something similar. Everybody says, oh, you know, Santiago gets everything, and we get this crumbs off the table. And so it's the typical, you know, bitching and moaning of countries like that. But the question I'm really interested in, and I'll explain why I'm so interested in this in a moment, is the leadership class of Russia as detached from the regular people as the leadership class of the West? Have you seen that kind of detachment, or are they closer? And if they are closer, why?
I think they're definitely not as detached, because they are they explain to the population, here's what we're doing. For example, even with the Russia-Ukraine conflict, they have breakdowns as to what's going on. Like, they explain flat out, okay, this is how many weapons we have, how many soldiers have died, this is what we're doing. They involve the public in a lot of, just not the media only, but in events. They have a lot of nationalists. I don't necessarily want to say nationalists, but very focused on sovereignty, focused on Russian pride. There's a lot of holidays. There's a lot of things that are celebrated, especially, like I said, with the older population. There's, when you see a lot of the pro-Russian elements of flags, pride, whatever, all of that is, people know about their history. And that's one thing. I think the United States lacks in knowledge of their actual history. And in Russia, people know their history because the government ensures that they know their history. The government is always seems to be listening to the concerns of the public, at least more than in the United States. Of course, like I mentioned, people outside of Moscow feel Moscow gets everything. They, you know, a lot of people even in Moscow say we need to, you know, give more to the outer provinces. But that's something that every single country, as you mentioned, has gone through for centuries. And so I don't feel like people like Vladimir Putin and people like, you know, Sergey Lavrov are out of touch with their populations. I feel like they're more in tune with what the populations want. And I see it in terms of the life that people are leading. I don't see people really out there complaining and saying, oh, we want to get rid of Putin. Like, people have their criticisms and they, you know, they say them, but it's more of like, yes, you know, we could do this, we could do that. It's more localized, actually, the criticisms of certain mayors. They have actually applauded one of, I forget his name, but the most recent mayor of Moscow, who has really just beautified the city, got rid of a lot of trash, got, you know, put fountains in. People really appreciate that attention paid. And mm-hmm. I don't see the like in the United States, you see, for example, New York, Los Angeles, San Francisco, you see wealth, right? The extreme wealth and you see extreme poverty like right next to each other. You right. don't see that here. You see, yeah, you see there is wealth and there are oligarchs. Nobody's saying that there's not oligarchs. Nobody's saying that Russia is 100% free of corruption. But it's this idea that it's equitable to the United States that I think a lot of us have a problem with, because you're talking about a country that has resisted what the Western interventionism, that has defeated the Nazis and is now once again going towards that route to fighting this fascism that's coming in. And then you're also talking about a country that's been looked on as being just, oh, a country that has gas and that's it. Like, but there's a lot of culture. There's a lot of history. There's a lot of knowledge here. Most Russians know, for example, more than one language. Even if their American English isn't that great, or their British English isn't that great, they still know. They know more about our politics in the United States than we know about their politics. So I think that shows a population that understands history, understands their government, and understands the geopolitics far more. Is there also a sense of just you know, apathy from the youth? Yes. And I think that comes from just this sort of youthful lack of being alive during the times of like the Cold War. And I think that's a danger for any society. When you don't know your history, and when young people don't know their history, I think you have that danger of interventionism. And so I think that is something to look out for, because the youth still holds a very positive view of the West. And I don't blame them, but I think that's a lot of the propaganda. And I think that's why Russia is so heavy on you know, pushing back against the Western propaganda, because they, you know, the West constantly pushes propaganda on them. And so the moment they push back and say, hey, this is propaganda, then there's like, oh, Russia is trying to censor, blah, blah, yeah. blah, blah, blah. But it's like, yeah. but what do you, I mean, this is the reality.
Yeah, I mean, Russia is not censoring CNN or not preventing CNN from broadcasting in Russia. But I do believe that RT can't broadcast, or Sputnik can broadcast in the West. So who's really the censor here? Yeah, I have to say that the issue of the leadership class being out of touch with the people, which seems to be happening in the Netherlands, and certainly in the United States and the UK and all the rest of it, is something that I find deeply troubling. And that's why I was focusing on it so much. And so, Fiorella, I guess the answer is you believe, at least from your experience so far, that the Russian leadership is closer to their own people, is paying more attention to them than the leadership has to us.
Yeah, I don't see, even out, like you could say, oh, well, people could be protesting outside of Moscow. Yeah, but you don't see that. Like, you don't really see that as much. You see the youth kind of pushing back against the conservative norms. Right. Because again, because Russia is a more conservative country. The gender roles are more conservative. There is more, it's not even that it's religious, but there is like pride in the Orthodox religion, right? There's mm-hmm. pride in the churches. there's definitely more conservatism when it comes to the LGBTQ situation, where like people don't really openly aren't as open about their sexuality and stuff. But I don't see what the West says where there's like persecution. I saw two girls make out in the subway. Nobody batted an eye. I mean, it's definitely more conservative, and there's definitely more tabooness, and there's definitely people that aren't okay with it. I'm not saying there's not, but it's definitely not what the West describes as, like, they're literally going after people, like, and they're just, blah, blah. There's a lot of push towards that, towards the legalization of marijuana. People are not, and the younger people are not anti, you know, marijuana. It's just like people are just more under the radar about it. And it's kind of like Putin's government is more conservative in some ways, and some people don't like it, especially the youth. But that doesn't mean that, you know, it's something that people are out in the streets and protesting about, that because economics is everything, in my opinion. If you're economically okay, and if you are doing okay economically, and you can go and live your life and feed your families and have a roof over your head, sure, you may want to change these things, but you're going to do that through an electoral process, through a process of that isn't as hands-on in the streets. But why do you see all of these people in Europe protesting? Why do you see all of this pushback? It's because economics isn't fine in the EU. It's not fine in the West in general, in the United States especially. So you see more of as much of like a criticism there than here. And I don't think it's because Putin is shutting down every bit of criticism. I think it's because it's just most people are not compelled to feel that way.
Yeah. Oh, and by the way, I turned off my camera for a very simple reason. I've mentioned this to the chat before, and I'll tell you again. Unfortunately, I have kidney stones, and it takes a while to pass them. It takes like a month. And so unfortunately, I have to change positions periodically. And so I have to move my camera around. I have a laptop on, and so it's just easier to turn off the camera. Sorry about that. But, you know, it's my face. You're not missing much. So don't worry about it. But anyway, Joost, rather.
Yeah, you, well, there's something I would like. Okay, go ahead.
No, well, I'm interested in what you have to say.
No, there are two themes here coming up, and there are, I'm not sure, I mean, you were saying, and I think you're right, that do they have the leadership, any connection with what the people think, and you are, you're saying that in the West it's going less and less, in more or less, but on the other hand, you, something with Fiorella said, she said, is there any connection with your own history? Mm-hmm. And those two things, I think the main problem at the moment in the Netherlands or other Western countries, and more so in the United States, is that people have no idea who they are, where they come from, where they're going to. They just live in the here and now, and they want to make up a kind of identity out of nothing. Saying, oh, I'm transgender, or I'm this or that, or making it up and making it a very big thing without, and that's also what I see when I talk to a lot of people. And if there, I mean, maybe a bit more with younger people than older people, but I'm not sure. I think of the older people, you see the same thing. And in the Netherlands, it has always been a very internationalized country, because it's a little country, it's a rich country, and we make our money out of dealing with other countries and shipping things from here to there and making a lot of money out of it. I mean, that has been so for 400 or 500 years, so, and it's still working okay. But the other hand is that we are losing in this time now more the connection with who we are and where we came from, and in that aspect the farms are very interesting. But because when you do have a farm, your family has the farm, and the people before you have the farm, whole generations do have the same farm, and you have, and you know, you have this feeling that the land you're living, it's not just something you make profit out of it, but it's also a feeling with a connection you have with the land. And I don't want to make it too sound too romantic, because it's also a business, but it is so. And it's also different with people living in the big streets, in the big city, and people living outside the city. they lived there, and I saw some signs about it, that when you look at families living there, they're living there for ages. Sometimes they live in the same place for generation after generation for 400 or 500 years, and you don't expect sick. You think we are some, you know, we are somewhere living in out of nowhere, and we're moving away from everywhere, and it doesn't matter where you come from. And I don't know so much. I mean, I meet some Russian people, but I think in Russia, this, I'm not sure about young people, but I think in Russia, this whole feeling of, as being part of a whole community, of a whole society, is much stronger than it is in countries like the Netherlands at the moment. And I think the connection with the people who are in power is that they have the same thing, but even more stronger. That people in power, they live in the Netherlands, for example, they live in an international world. They act more like
conquerors. The leaders of the West act more like colonial powers, you know, administrators.
When there were colonial powers and there were conquerors, they know where they're fighting for, they know where they're connected with. But those people, they have no connection at all. They just don't care about the country where they live, and they don't care about in a way you're right, they care about having more power in that way, but that's an abstract thing. It's not about it's about an ideology. It's not about it's not about people who are going to war for the country, because going to war is not a possibility anymore, because nobody in this country we're talking about, these Western countries, have any clue what they would have to fight for. So when you would ask anybody in the Netherlands, would you like to fight for the Netherlands? Well, not much.
Would you like to fight for the EU?
Even less. So it's not. There's no real army anymore, and there people don't want to die for the country. I mean, some did. I mean, I have to be honest that some did in Afghanistan, for example. People died there, but
almost for nothing, unfortunately.
Right, absolutely right. It's for America, you know. It's not for the net. Had nothing to do with the Netherlands, I think but that's the main problem. I mean, I think this is also happening in Russia, because there is one reason why Putin is not going into a full mobilization. I think because he's afraid that not too many people want to die for this. And so
do you think so, Fiorella? Do you think that's part of the reason that he hasn't gone for full mobilization? Because in the West, all the analysts are talking about the fact that Putin has not gone for full mobilization. I have a theory of my own, but go ahead, Fiorella. I'd love to hear what you think.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people here didn't want to get involved in this. Even in spite of understanding why it was done, a lot of people just didn't want the economy to suffer. They didn't want any sort of pushback from the West. Some of the criticisms that have been launched at Putin have been for getting into this conflict because it did affect Russia, especially in the beginning. Now, obviously, it boomeranged, right? But a lot of people were afraid of, oh my God, like I'm not able to use, you know, this, I'm not able to use that. It's gonna, like, there was a lot of fear mongering too in listening to the West. A lot of people, you know, oh, I'm leaving because this country's gonna go down, blah, blah, blah. They let the fear sort of get to them. And so one of the criticisms on Putin from one side was, oh, we don't wanna get involved because this is gonna hurt our economy. It's gonna ruin our country. We shouldn't do this. And also there's that sentiment towards Ukraine. A lot of people have family in Ukraine, et cetera. And then on the other end, of course, you have the people in the Donbass who were asking and criticizing Putin for not getting involved sooner. So now this, if Putin were to mobilize fully, I think he would get a lot of criticism from people who are like, okay, enough, like we got it. It's fine. They don't want to feel what Ukraine is feeling. They don't want to really go down for this. They don't see it as necessary, as especially younger people that I've spoken to, because they don't see the West as big as a threat. And I find that a little bit dangerous, a little bit, you know, like, okay, But I also understand, because a lot of these people weren't alive even 20 years ago. I mean, this is like, we're talking about, you know, the Cold War, and we're talking about the 90s. Some of these people are under 30, so they're not going to know very much at all. And so that there's definitely a push for Putin to not go all the way and disrupt the life that Russians are living, because Russians really do enjoy like this community. They enjoy their families, very much family oriented population, unlike a lot of what we see in the West. I mean, in the United States, for example, as an immigrant, definitely, you know, more several generations of people who live in the United States, right? They are less tied to their families, you know, like coming from a Latin background, you focus more on family, you focus more on that community. I feel like a lot of that's been lost in a lot of Western countries, and Russia, for being a country in Eurasia, is extremely very much focused on family. And I find that that's a reason why people don't really want to get involved in this further. And I think that's where criticism against Putin could definitely come further if he continues in that route.
Yeah, because in so far as the military situation is concerned in Ukraine, the Russians really do not need any kind of full mobilization. With the army that they have deployed, which is really an expeditionary force, because they haven't really used the entirety of the Russian military, they're handling the situation very well on their own. They don't need to call up everybody. And on top of that, there's something else that people forget, is that when you do a generalized call up, it takes several weeks, if not months, to get everybody up to speed so that they can be effective in any kind of capacity other than the most basic, you know, law and order type, you know, just have troops there to make sure that keep an eye on things kind of thing. In terms of combat or anything like that, you need months. And so the Russians are doing very well, and they're winning. They're at the point that, you know, they're going to overrun the Kramatorsk line. And after that, it'll, God knows where it'll go. But there is simply no way for the Ukraine, for the Zelensky regime, rather, to eke out any kind of victory. It's impossible at this point. And so the issue becomes, how is this end game going to be played out? Will it be just the Zelensky regime against the Russian forces, or will NATO somehow get involved? But be that as it may, that's something that we'll have to, take care of, you know, discuss, you know, sorry, I got distracted here. But I'll mention why I'm...
I agree what you say here, that they're doing fine and they are winning this war. I agree with that. But I think something in the world really changed. I mean, when I look at pictures from the First World War, I see all those hundreds of thousands of men running and being happy that they're going to the front and dying by the millions. Mm. Because of their country, because they feel that they're so... I mean, I'm not agreeing to that, because it's awful what happened there. And even with the Second World War, it was something like this, because they feel that they were connected and they have to die for something. But now everywhere in the world, and I think even in China will have a big problem with getting mobilization of all the Chinese people. And of course, we saw that already happening in the United States. The reason why the United States isn't as strong as it used to be is because they cannot get... they have to use technology and they send drones, etc., to win a war. But they cannot send soldiers anymore. I mean, not enough. And no. I think that's totally different than let's say 100 or 50 years ago.
Well, what's interesting is that everybody says NATO is so big and all the rest of it, but when you start actually looking at the combat troops that NATO can field,
yeah, it's none nothing.
Of them, it's nothing. No. And what's very interesting is that early in the war, the Russians, when they fired on Yavoriv, the center that's basically a NATO training center in Ukraine that was about about 25 miles from the border with Poland on the western end of Ukraine, the Russians fired a barrage of hypersonic missiles at it, early in the war. I think it was around like the 7th of March, I want to say, something like that. And they totally destroyed it. They killed something like 400 foreign fighters who were there, who were getting ready to be deployed, and who were clearly the advance force to bring in NATO troops. They also destroyed something like $400 million worth of weaponry. I mean, it was a complete disaster. And it was clearly a message that the Russians were sending. Basically, the message was, we can hit you anywhere we want to, whenever we want to, and you won't even see it coming until it's too late, which is exactly what happened.
Yeah,
and
I after think it that, was NATO, at the same time that they were saying, well, maybe we can go nuclear if you like to.
Well, yeah, the West has been saying that. The West has been going insane.
No, but Putin said something like this. When the NATO would do something, we can go nuclear.
He put it all on the line. He said he's not going to screw around. But you know, this whole situation, I keep returning to is the issue of leadership, and I'll explain why. Because at this time, I'm writing a book on Western leadership class and their failures, and why now it seems that our leadership class has driven us, our society, into a ditch. The Western society, I mean. And that's why I'm obsessing about this. And if I keep on going on and on about the leadership classes, it's because I've got this on the brain, so you'll have to forgive me. But the thing I can't get over is how the leadership class, instead of pausing, taking a time to think it over, and making an intelligent decision in the best interests of the West, they just keep doubling down on bad policy after bad policy. And I want to ask you, Fiorella, you know, you've seen the hysteria of the Western leadership class, and I'm sure that the people you speak to in Russia are fairly sophisticated individuals. How do they view the Western leadership class when compared to their own leadership class? Because, for instance, I look at Sergei Lavrov, who is a statesman. Whatsoever you may think of him as a man, he knows what he's doing. He's a grown-up. He is handling things, and he knows how to build bridges, and he knows how to conduct diplomacy, whereas Anthony Blinken is an idiot. Liz Truss is a fool. Do people in Russia recognize this, or do they not pay attention to such granular detail?
It depends on who you're talking about. If you're talking about people in media or people that are well-educated.
Yeah, more educated media people. What's their opinion? How do they see this as a failure of the Western leadership class, or do they think that this was an inevitability? How do they view this?
They view this as arrogance, as the United States trying to hold on to its title as this unilateral dictatorial entity. I mean, the United States goes around calling everybody dictators, right? But I mean, the United States has for a long time, admittedly. I mean, I forget, was it one of them just said, yes, we used to, was it, I think it was Marco Rubio or Ted Cruz, I forget which one, but we used to have this unilateral world, this position where we were the go-tos, that we would decide what was going on, and that's changed, and they lament it. They lament that it's changed, and so a lot of people that I speak to here see that as arrogance, as this attempt to hold on to power, you know, depending on if they're more anti- Western than others, they'll say that it's, you know, it's just a product of what the West has always been like, or how they just always acted, versus like, no, this is their attempt to continue exerting control, expanding this control over everybody else. And, you know, any sort of pushback is looked on as an attack instead of just pushback. You could look at China. You could look at China's response and Russia's response. For example, in the United States, when China didn't go and take Pelosi's plane down, a lot of Americans were like, well, that's weak, blah, blah, blah. And it's like, well, the United States has a tendency, and some of their people don't even realize that even that mindset of using a gun or using something militaristic right away is the very American way, always just going straight for that attack. Whereas the Chinese and the Russians are more methodical. It's like two different strategies in chess playing. You have the person that goes, puts their moves out in front and just goes and attacks the same way always. And then you have the person that's watching, sitting back, looking five moves ahead, and is like, okay, we're gonna do this. In China's case, we're going to go against them economically. We're going to go and attack them where it hurts right now. In Russia's case, well, we're not going to respond to these attacks with the most force, but we're going to do what we can to show that we're pushing back. So it's just, it's a different way of thinking. I agree. Sergei Lavrov compared to Anthony Blinken, right? You see it in the reactions that both had in Africa. When Anthony Blinken went to Africa, they felt like they were trying to boss these African countries around, particularly South Africa spoke out about that. And then Sergei Lavrov went, they were like, thank you for working with us, for this cooperation, for this equitable relationship where you're not literally telling us what to do, because hey, we're an African country. We've had centuries of colonialism. That's the last thing we want. And the Soviet Union, of course, had a relationship with helping Africa decolonize. So it's this whole thing where the West just has this arrogance. And no matter how people feel about Putin, no matter how people feel about the United States, everybody does perceive, for the most part, that the West, that the United States in particular, when we're talking about the West, is arrogant and they want things done their way.
Yeah. I mean, the conceitedness. Yeah. And just to go back to this issue of the conceitedness, because I look at your prime minister and he seems incredibly conceited. And because what's interesting is that just like you were talking about, Fiorella, about Blinken and the U.S. State Department officials basically bossing the Africans around, in the Netherlands, you have Rutte, who is basically bossing people around. And as I understand, he's basically refusing to negotiate with the farmers, or putting such conditions that no negotiation is really plausible. Is there an exit for this problem with in the Netherlands, or is it going to come to some sort of crisis point?
Yeah, it's an interesting point, because we used to think about this Premier Rutte as not so much a leader, but a manager. And I think that's leadership in the world today is management, basically, because they all go to the same schools and they learn how to deal with problems coming on the table. And management is a way to get out of conflict. And a manager doesn't have a vision. He doesn't know where to go to. And I think that has always been the problem with Rutte, that and he says it openly, because he doesn't care. He didn't care about having a vision, having an idea. He never talks about it openly, what he wants with the Netherlands, or what's the problem, or who are we working with. It's just problems come at his table, and he thinks, how can we deal with it so that the powers that be will be the less trouble? And that's going on. But you're right. Now something new is going on, that he is not dealing with the problems anymore, because the problems, you could say, the problems now are the farmers, because they are demanding a change in policy. And so you normally in the Dutch society, where the so-called polder model, which is you cannot translate it into English, because it's really the model of working together, as in the polder, the mm-hmm. area where the people made land out of the sea. They have to work together, because otherwise you will drown in the water. So it's simple as that. So all the people have to work together. So, and we used to be pretty famous in the 90s and in the 80s for last century about our polder model. So we didn't have big strikes. But that's changing now, because the problems are getting too big. We want too much with too little a country. And the problems are getting bigger and bigger all the time. And you have to, you need a leader who knows where we have to go to. And we don't have that leader and at this moment.
Is there any such leader on the horizon in the Netherlands?
It's difficult. I see some people who I really think they are intelligent and have good ideas, but they are always representing a small group. And what you need is somebody who comes up and everybody agrees, okay, let's go for him. And that's not so much happening at the moment. So I cannot answer that. on the other hand, sometimes people you don't expect to, will grow to be a real leader. That's possible. But at the moment, I don't see that happening.
Jesus Christ. Because like in the United States, at least, there is no person except perhaps Ron DeSantis, who seems like a next generation of leaders who actually cares about the people. Yeah. And so it's deeply troubling in the United States because the entire leadership class seems to be, like I said, detached from the people, and they don't care about the people, and they exploit the people. They look at the people as something to be milked and then sent to the slaughter, as the case may be.
But what in your opinion, what are good leaders? Give me some examples that say, okay, that's a good leader. That was a good leader.
Okay, a good leader in the abstract would be a leader who cares.
No, just a concrete person in history or something.
Teddy Roosevelt. That's an uncontroversial example, because if you pick anybody of the last 100 years, you know, you're going to go into all kinds of, you know, people are going to get all kinds of upset. But, you know, Teddy Roosevelt, to give an example, mm-hmm. he actually cared mm-hmm. about the United States. He cared about the workers. He cared about the environment. He cared about making the United States a better country than it was. Okay. You do not see that in the last, you know, 50 years. Well, perhaps you could say Ronald Reagan, because he, I do not doubt that he genuinely wanted a better country and that he wanted, you know, morning in America and all that. I don't doubt his sincerity in that. I do question the people he had on board and the people backing him that seemed more, what you call it, they seemed more, how could I put it, rapacious. I think that they were rather rapacious as opposed to, really trying to make a better country, though Reagan himself, but... Go ahead.
I think it depends on what you signify as a good leader, because, you know, to me, like, a good leader should be leading people towards something better. either. I just don't see Reagan in that respect, just because aside from what you pointed out, like maybe his personal desires, what happened, of course, was a lot of issues in the United States because of Reagan politics. I think a lot of neoliberalism that we're living in now stems from that, in my opinion. And then also, you know, Ron DeSantis, I think a lot of people felt like because of what he dealt with COVID, that he was okay. And like, I think his COVID policies in Florida were, you know, one of the better ones in terms of not shutting down, in terms of not following the whole BS, right? Mm-hmm. But in terms of just still playing party politics, I think he still plays that. I think he still plays this sort of team sports mentality between the left and the right and all of this. And I think he would be very much like Trump, if not more interventionist. And that's what I really look at. I look at a leader that isn't going to give us the same old status quo interventionist policies that end up putting us in the right, right where we were all, like right where we were. And I think, I have more of a pessimistic view. I don't think there is anybody right now in the United States that is an effective leader. I think the closest thing that people could see, I think, is maybe somebody in the Libertarian Party. But even that, like, it's just, there's just so much just division. There's so much just so much like culture war BS hitting back and forth between the left and right. And like the economic issues get lost in that. The issues of anti-interventionism get lost in that. If we could agree, not just on ending the wars, on stopping interventionism, on focusing on rebuilding our infrastructure, on focusing on the American people, and also stopping our involvement abroad, and focusing on allowing, you know, us having a free speech, a freedom of the press, basic rights that we had. I think people could unite around that, but there's just so many like divisions within each sector, whether it's the right or the left or whatever it calls itself, the left, it's just really bad. And I think a lot of that is by design, because the people are focused on each other instead of the global elitist, just psychopaths that are trying to really send us down this route. And I think that's part of the huge problem, is if people sit down and talk, people with opposing ideologies, which is why I always talk to people who disagree with me on a lot of things, because I think in some ways, some of us are misinformed about the other. And, you know, I'm not saying go unite with the Azov Battalion, but I am saying have conversations with people who may think differently than you, which is why I go on shows like this, where people are going to think differently than me. So I think that is really important, is to really highlight the fact that there's a lack of conversation, a lack of nuance. It's more of like, here's my side, here's my team, and that's it. And I'm going to hate you, and I'm not going to listen to anything you have to say.
You know, that thing of listening to other people, you know, setting up these roundtables, it takes a lot of effort in terms of booking. I mean, Fiorella, you'd be very familiar with that. You know, it's hard to book people, you know, because they're busy, and it's a little bit like wrangling cats. But the thing is, see, I recently made a concerted effort to reach out to people with whom I completely disagree in so far as different issues, especially the current conflict here in the Ukraine. Because I was hearing all kinds of things that just didn't correspond to reality as far as I understood it. And so I made a concerted effort to try to get people who had different viewpoints. And I told them, look, I'll be extremely civil. I will, you know, let you say whatever you want to say, just so long as you bring your facts and you have them in order. And I mean, I didn't do it like a, you know, just I wanted to hear what they had to say. And I would, just as I'm talking to you both, I would give them as open a platform and as much space as they needed to formulate their points of view. And they all declined. They all ran away. They blocked me. Sometimes they deliberately sort of like picked fights, you know, like insulting me and trying to provoke me. And when, of course, I refused to be characterized as a propagandist or a whatever, I mean, all kinds of nasty comments. Then they automatically said, oh, see, that just shows that, you know, you're not in good faith. Of course, it was just provoking in order to create a reaction so as to create the justification to not go on. It's, how can I put it? There seems to be a group of people who do not have facts on their side, who are living in some sort of fantasy land. And what Joost was saying before of how they try to create identities out of thin air, they try to create facts out of thin air. And of course, when somebody pushes back on them, they refuse to engage and instead call you names. And it's just, you know, it's just incredibly annoying. And by the way, while I'm talking to you, I'm unfortunately having to do moderation. I've got like a bunch of trolls that are like hitting my my chat. And it's just ridiculous because all they're trying to do is derail any kind of intelligent conversation. It's like something has happened that polarization is inevitable. And when you have polarization as a society, you inevitably wind up with some sort of civil war, quite frankly. I mean, that's
everybody is angry.
Yeah. You know, and that's the thing. Everybody's angry and mindlessly angry. Mm-hmm. That's the thing that I find troubling. They're just mm-hmm. lashing out, and many times they don't even know the origins of their anger. They're just lashing out, you know, throwing it's extremely frustrating, especially because I was raised to believe that you ought to engage with your the people that disagree with you on politics or on any kind of policy, that you should engage with them and try to, if not compromise, then at least understand the other point of view. But now we are currently engaged in a society that does not care to listen to the other. They only want to shout to one another. It's deeply depressing because I don't think that this is going to have a happy ending. Sorry for rambling on, but you know that's
no.
That's
I totally agree with what you're saying, but and maybe then going back to the question of leadership. How can one be a leader of all those different angry people who are only shouting at each other? I mean, that's
the problem. Yeah.
But I was wondering, because I asked you the question, can you come up with a person? And I agree with Ronald Reagan. I really think he was kind of a father of the country at that moment, also controversial. But controversial isn't the point. I mean, you are always controversial when you are a leader because you make choices. But I'm a bit surprised that that you didn't name Putin as a good leader, because I really think he is. He made a lot of mistakes, and he is controversial. But when you look at where Russia was at the moment when he came on and where Russia is at the moment, it's an enormous difference.
Insofar as any contemporary leader, I'm holding off on any kind of judgment, because you can only really make a full judgment at the end of the day. And oh, and there's Fiorella. Yeah, you were like fading out. You were like just fading out into black. It was pretty funny. We do have to wind down because I want to respect Fiorella's time. She does unfortunately have to go. And so before we go, do you guys have any final thoughts as to anything in particular, anything that you want to stress in this conversation that's been a little bit, you know, all over the place? But as far as I'm concerned, a lot of times those are the most fun. Fiorella or Joost, either one of you, if you have like a final thought or something that you want to emphasize before we go.
Go ahead.
Okay. Well, no, just the fact that, you know, I recommend people listen to viewpoints that are different than their own, obviously. And if you have a question about how something really is, if you can go to that country, you know, talk to those people. This is one of the reasons why I came to Moscow, is because as much as I could assess that a lot of the things that were being told in the United States were false, it's different to be here and really live it, and really it exceeded the expectations as to how far away from what people think it is. It's so different than what people think it is. And if people are still, you know, are you okay? We're worried about you, blah, blah, blah. They think like, you know, I'm under some sort of like threat. It's hilarious that people think that. And so this is why I recommend people go to these places. If you are a journalist, if you're not, if you just want to visit, by all means, try to do that, to expand your horizons, to talk to different people. I really think it does open up your mind. And Yeah, I agree. I mean, I don't agree with a lot of people in general, and I have a very, you know, different perspective than on certain things than say Gonzalo, but I will sit here and have a conversation because on certain things we do agree, and I will talk about those things as well. So,
what do you think that we disagree about? I'm curious.
Well, I mean, I think I'm more left, I'm politically left leaning, and you're not, right? So I think there's that element, and I still think it's okay. And it's funny, and I find it hilarious that we agree on this, the Western, you know, interventionism. We agree that this conflict is definitely a NATO push on the West. And I think people will sometimes on the left will function from ideology first, and same on the right. They'll function from ideology first. They won't talk to somebody if their ideology isn't shared. And I think we need to start talking about the truth first.
I mean, like in my own case, I actually didn't know that you were on the left or you considered yourself to be politically at odds with me, because my priority has always been just, what are the facts? What's the accurate representation of reality? You know, that's been always my concern. I don't really care about, you know, left, right. If you were to peg me on a political, line from the extreme left to the extreme right, yeah, I would say that I'm hard right. I definitely think that the Bismarckian kind of social welfare system has been a detriment to the people, and that it should be removed because it prevents people from developing close relationships with their family and their extended family, as had been tradition before the invention of the welfare state, which I think has brought about a state which replaces the family as the social group to give psychological and emotional support and financial support to people. I think that estate charity of any sort is bad for the people because it's a short-term fix and it makes everybody feel better. But that's not important. What's important is that, see, you and I agree that the facts should come first. And we should strive to have accurate facts that accurately represent reality and not live in any kind of fantasy land insofar as what is true or false. I mean, we can agree on that, right, Fiorella?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
And what seems to me the problem is that the left in particular over the last 15 years has become detached from reality. It's sort of like they only pay attention to the reality that they want, you know, sort of like the whole issue of like, oh, you know, yeah, I was born with, you know, double X chromosomes. But, you know, today now I feel, you know, that I'm really a man. And so now I'm a man. I identified as male. But it's like you're distorting reality. You see my point, that people think that reality is an a la carte kind of menu that you can pick and choose what's real and what's not. And if it's not on the menu, you can just make it up. And reality doesn't work that way. You know, it's you're crossing the street and you say to yourself, I choose not to accept the reality of that truck coming down the road. Well, if you cross the street and pretend that the truck isn't there, the truck is going to kill you, whether you believe in it or not, you know. And so my thinking is we should pay attention to reality and strive to have reality and facts above everything else, and only then come to discussions as to how to best solve certain social problems that are commonly shared. I mean, that seems to be my opinion. That is my opinion. And that seems to me to be the logical way to solve problems of a society. But to me, and I'm not referring to you, Fiorella, I'm just generally, it seems that the left, they ditched facts and reality. That seems to be what I perceive. Do you agree with this, or you think that there's something else going on?
I think the perception of what is left in the United States isn't a good representation of what the left is in other places, places in Africa, places in West Asia, in Latin America. It's more focused on economics, less on social positions, like social issues. The left in certain countries that I've been to are economically focused on empowering the people, the workers, versus abortion rights or something like that. And so that's considered left in those countries, whereas what's left in the United States is, you know, do you support pronouns? Do you support trans rights? I mean, I'm pretty like open. I don't care what people, who people choose to love, how people choose to call themselves. What I don't like is the hyper focusing on that as a handicap to push the same type of imperialism, the same type of neoliberal economic policies. And I think that's what my issue is with the quote unquote left in the United States, is that they use those issues as crutches to completely ignore economics. And that's driven, of course, by the national security state apparatus, by the covert agencies, because they know that if they hire the intersectional imperialists, which is what we have in the United States right now, we have Kamala Harris, we have Secretary of Defense, we have
Lloyd Austin,
we have also the Joe Biden's press secretary. We have all of these people that are, of course, intersectional. And, you know, I think to a degree that did matter. But then you have, you know, that is what has allowed the identity politics without any sort of actual substance, tangible work towards actually helping people, is what my problem is. The weaponization of the Latino population, of the Black population, for votes without actually doing anything to help people. I think that is what really gets to me. And I think that's where I don't see that as a real left. I see that as just like another neoliberal co-opted agenda. And I think that those people are what make the right, you know, have these very negative views about, you know, things like socialism. I think that's where that's coming from. But that's not what it all is. I think there's just a lot of people that are more focused on economics in other parts of the world that are actually conservative on social issues too. So I think there's room to have these discussions with those people and to really see that are different layers and different aspects that go beyond the usual left-right paradigm, you know, the usual pro-trans, anti-trans. There's just all of these things happening that are a distraction. And I think it's a very privileged position that the West has when they focus on these social issues, when other people are focused on having a roof over their head, having water, having electricity, having things that really cement their economic status. The idea even of feminism in the United States is completely different in other parts of the world. Feminism doesn't mean, you know, a slogan or voting for Hillary Clinton. It means
hating men.
Going to school. It doesn't mean hating men. It means, you know, having some sort of equitable, just monetary existence to a degree. It doesn't mean what it means to everybody in the United States. So I think there's room to discuss, what does it mean? What is left? What is this? What is that? And I just think, like, on both ends, people just make up these ideas about what somebody on the left is, what somebody on the right is. And I think that's changing. I definitely think that's changing because of the state of where we're at. So, yeah, I'm glad to discuss. And I would discuss with anybody, like, again. So,
all right, a final question out of curiosity, and feel free if you don't want to answer. How long do you intend to stay in Moscow?
I'm not sure. I mean, I will be here for at least a year, and then we'll see about that. You know, it's been great so far. I am trying to learn Russian, so I'm going to start taking classes, because that's, to me, for me, the hardest thing besides the sanction stuff is not knowing Russian. It's a completely different alphabet. It's different. So it's not like I can just like pick it up. It's not a Romance language. It's not a Germanic language. I know some German, so it's not that. So it's different. So I think that's the hardest part. So we'll see. It'll be at least a year. So I'll be here for a little bit still.
Cool. Yeah, cool. Joost, what was your final thought? Because we got derailed. It was a very interesting conversation with Fiorella. But Joost, what are your final thoughts before we get going?
Well, it seems like going on this topic about left and right. I'm getting more and more confused about what all this actually means. I agree. Yeah. I just can give you two examples which are surprised me. I have a friend who is from Morocco, and he calls himself left, and he said, of course, all the left people hate the Islam. And I said, okay, that's interesting, because in the Netherlands, all the left people agree with the Islam, even when the Islam is a conservative ideology. So you see how difficult these things get, because there are multicultural ideals, and they say Islam is part of this, so going against the Islam is racist or something like that. Mm-hmm. This is one example. Okay. The other example is globalism. Left people used to be anti-globalist. In the 90s, there was a big anti-globalist movement, which was left movement. And then suddenly, this all went away. And when you're anti-globalist now, you are a right wing. It does say that what I would call myself left, by the way, because I have a different opinion about economy than you do, Gonzalo. I really think that that the state has an important function for poor people, helping them, and mm-hmm. I would say that's old fashioned left. But I think most populist people are in fact left wing people, but they are called now extreme right. So you can only laugh at that, because it doesn't mean anything.
I'm not laughing at you, please.
No. But people laugh at that. But when I would call myself left, people, they laugh at me because they say, yeah, but no, of course you are extreme right wing and blah blah blah. But that says a lot about the meaning of. I mean, it's all about values. It's about caring for people who don't have it. Good and see that you can happen. Okay, it's possible that you do this in a more family-like way, caring for the people who are next to you, and because that's maybe more effective. But also, a state can do a lot of things about it. And I think in that aspect, but on the other hand, I'm very nationalistic. So that would maybe other people call right-wing at the same time.
Well, is that what I do have to point out that you in the Netherlands are exceptionally lucky, because your state, I live there, so I know, they are very efficient. They take care of things. The bureaucracy is very organized. I had to do different bureaucratic tasks, you know, than usual things when you live in a country. And everything was so organized, so orderly, so efficient. Everything worked, you know, from public works to everything. I remember specifically, I was living in Amsterdam. I remember I was on crutches because I broke one of my feet, and I was walking on it, and I pushed down a brick on one of the bridges I had to go over, and I, right by my house, and I noticed it, and I couldn't do anything about it. I was on crutches, and I kept on going, and I noticed that 2 days later, they had come and fixed it, and it was perfect. It was perfectly new, you know, by magic. And it was a tiny little thing that had happened there. I've seen up close and personal how efficient the Dutch state is, but the problem is that that's unique. Most other states are a complete disaster. And I personally think that a distributist model would be more efficient, but that's for another conversation. I'm very aware that Fiorella has to go. And so I'm going to wind it down. I want to thank you both for having come over. Once again, Chad, I'm sorry that I'm not on camera, but I'm basically lying on my side so as to ease the unpleasantness of this kidney stone. But I want to thank both of my guests for having come on, Joost Niermolder and Fiorella Isabel. I'll put the links where you can find them below. That's something I forgot to ask you guys. And after the show, I'll ask you to send me your... the links that you want in the description where people can find you. And chat, thank you so much, and I will catch you next time. Take care.
Bye.
Nero. Now get 25% off coffee and pastry 7 days a week with Compare the Market.
Our next story is from South Africa. It's been 3 decades since South Africa abolished apartheid, a system of racially segregating black people from white people. The country got rid of it in the 1990s, but the spirit of apartheid is still alive in some places. One of them is Orania, a remote town in the country's north, often called the last outpost of apartheid. Why? Because Orania is a whites-only town. Black people cannot live or work here. Every job is reserved for the whites. Every task performed by white people. And yet the residents of this town insist they're not racist. Here's a report.
Welcome to Orania, a remote farming town in South Africa's Northern Cape. It prints its own money, runs its own banks, has its own holidays, and manages its own affairs. Sounds like the perfect township to relocate, right? Well, hold your horses. To enter Orania, you have to qualify on certain parameters. The foremost is the color of your skin. It has to be white, because Orania is a whites-only town. The uniqueness is too obvious to ignore. Wherever you go in this township, you will only find Afrikaners. White people with Dutch ancestry. They do all the work, from playing the piano at the church to reading out the Bible to believers, to running the kitchen at a restaurant. To even gardening at orchards. All jobs, big or small, are reserved for white people. But the residents of this town insist that they're not racist.
We are from Africa, that's why we call ourselves Afrikaners. We want to remain here. We also want to retain our identity. Now, to retain one's identity is not a racist impulse. We wanted to retain our identity against the English or the British imperialism also, and they're even whiter than we are, much whiter.
Orania is often dubbed as the last outpost of apartheid, a system of institutionalized racial segregation. South Africa abolished apartheid in the 1990s. But the legacy lives on in Orania. In fact, the township was founded by the son-in-law of Hendrik Verwoerd, South Africa's former prime minister, who's considered to be the architect of apartheid. Verwoerd's bust lies at the museum in this township, serving as a reminder of his beliefs. As for Nelson Mandela, the man credited with ending apartheid, the people of Orania don't really hold him in high regard.
I don't think that I can see him as a hero, because he's part of a whole package. Mandela is part of a whole package. And as Mandela, all the other leaders within the ANC make a contribution to create some policy that is, from our viewpoint, not necessarily for the best of this country.
Mandela is not a hero, they say. And they're not racist, they insist. So what is this town all about? An attempt to protect their culture. This township is legal as per South Africa's constitution. An article defends its right to self-determination. But Orania's ambitions could soon spell trouble. Because the people here say their next goal is the creation of an Afrikaner Republic, a white-only autonomous region within South Africa. Bureau Report, WEON, World is One.
WEON is now available in your country. Download the app now and get all the news on the move.
On the occasion of India having completed 75 years of her independence, I wish to express my sincere congratulations.
Greetings from the International Space Station. It is a pleasure to congratulate India on 75 years of independence.
India is celebrating today 75 years of independence, the journey and the achievements. It is also talking about what lies ahead. The Prime Minister of India set the tone with a speech from the Red Fort. It's an occasion that leaders usually use to recount their successes and to announce new schemes, even score some political points. But today was different. Today, Prime Minister Modi laid out a roadmap. At 75, which direction will India choose for itself? Which goals will India set for itself? And how will it achieve them? This was Prime Minister Modi's ninth speech from the Red Fort. It wasn't his longest. That was in 2016. He spoke for 94 minutes in 2016. Today, his speech lasted about 82 minutes. And in this address, he articulated his vision for the next 25 years. The most significant takeaways were the five pledges, or the Panch Pran, as we say in Hindi. Number one, a developed India by 2047. That's the 100th year, the year of independence, 2047. Number two, shed all traces of the colonial mindset. Number three, take pride in your roots. Number four, he spoke about unity, but he talked about ending misogyny. And number five, the sense of duty, your duty as a citizen. And this was a reminder of sorts for all citizens to fulfill their civic duties. Now, let's tell you about the pledges one by one. First, the goal of a developed India. With a 25-year target, this is an ambitious pledge. How are countries classified as developed? On different parameters, the most commonly used are indicators like GDP and per capita income, basically the average earning of a citizen. Now, for comparison's sake, the United States has a GDP of almost $20 trillion. Per capita income, almost $60,000. Japan has a GDP of well over $12 trillion. Per capita income, over $38,000. Germany, GDP almost $5 trillion. Per capita income, over $44,000. France, GDP $2.5 trillion. Per capita income, almost $40,000. What about India? Where does India stand today? India's GDP is around $2.6 trillion. Per capita income is less than $2,000. Do you see the gap here? While India is catching up on GDP, even ahead of some of these countries, it has a long way to go on per capita income. So what is Prime Minister Modi's game plan to make India developed? He's calling on the country's youth to step up.
For Salon, beautiful styles. Schwarzkopf Styling.
Mere desh ke naujawano, जब देश आजादी के 100 साल मनाएगा तब आप 50-55 के हुए होंगे, मतलब आपके जीवन का ये स्वर्णिम काल, आपकी उम्र के ये 25-30 साल भारत के सपनों को पूरा करने का काल है। आप संकल्प लेकर के मेरे साथ चल पड़िए साथियों, तिरंगे झंडे के शपथ लेकर के चल पड़िए, हम सब पूरी ताकत से लगे आए। बड़ा संकल्प, मेरा देश विकसित देश होगा।
That's pledge number one. Pledge number two is about shedding the colonial mindset. What does that mean? It means take pride in your country, stop seeking validation from the rest of the world, and shun the mindset of servitude. And New Delhi has led by example in its recent dealings with the world, like buying Russian oil despite pressure from the West and Europe, or telling America to fix its own issues before commenting on India's democracy. Today, Prime Minister Modi asked citizens to stand up for their identity.
कभी-कभी तो हमारी टैलेंट भाषा के बंधनों में बंध जाती है। ये गुलामी की मानसिकता का परिणाम है। हमें हमारे देश की हर भाषा पे गर्व होना चाहिए। वो हमें भाषा आती हो या ना आती हो, लेकिन मेरे देश की भाषा है, मेरे पूर्वजों ने दुनिया को दी हुई ये भेंट सौगात है, हमें गर्व होना चाहिए।
Pledge number three is linked to that message. It's about taking pride in India's heritage. Now, this has been a mission of sorts for the Modi government, from the push for yoga to the campaign to promote Ayurveda. India is using its heritage as its USP.
जब हम अपनी धरती से जुड़ेंगे, जब हम अपनी धरती से जुड़ेंगे तभी तो ऊंचा उड़ेंगे। और जब हम ऊंचा उड़ेंगे तो हम विश्व को भी समाधान दे पाएंगे।
Pledge number 4, end misogyny. Prime Minister Modi asked India to take a pledge to stop disrespecting women. As he paid a tribute to freedom fighters like Rani Lakshmi Bai, he said India should push for gender equality, end casual sexism and abuse.
हमारी बोलचाल में, हमारी व्यवहार में, हमारे कुछ शब्दों में हम नारी का अपमान करते हैं। क्या हम स्वभाव से, संस्कार से, रोजमर्रा की जिंदगी में नारी को अपमानित करने वाली हर बात से मुक्ति का संकल्प ले सकते हैं?
And finally, pledge number 5, your duty as citizens. We all remember our fundamental rights, as we should, but very few of us talk about our fundamental duties. Today, the Prime Minister of India did.
ये शासन का काम है कि बिजली 24 घंटे पहुंचाने के लिए प्रयास करे, लेकिन ये नागरिक का कर्तव्य है कि जितनी ज्यादा यूनिट बिजली बचा सकते बचाएं। हर खेत में पानी पहुंचाना सरकार की जिम्मेवारी है, सरकार का प्रयास है, लेकिन पर ड्रॉप मोर क्रॉप, पानी बचाते हुए आगे बढ़ना, मेरे हर खेत से आवाज उठनी चाहिए। हर कोई अगर नागरिक के कर्तव्यों को निभाएगा तो मुझे विश्वास है कि हम इच्छित लक्ष्य को प्राप्त करने में समय से पहले सिद्धि प्राप्त कर सकते।
So these were the 5 pledges. The Prime Minister gave a new slogan to Jai Anusandhan, or Hail Innovation. This was a pitch for India's growing prowess in tech and innovation.
Amrit Kaal ke liye ek aur anivaryata hai, aur wo hai Jai Anusandhan. Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan, Jai Vigyan, Jai Anusandhan. Ye jo Digital India ka movement hai, जो सेमीकंडक्टर की ओर हम कदम मार रहे हैं, 5G की ओर कदम मार रहे हैं, हम ऑप्टिकल फाइबर गांव-गांव में पहुंचा रहे हैं, डिजिटल इंडिया का सपना गांव से गुजरेगा, ये मुझे पूरी जानकारी है।
So today's speech was futuristic and it did take into account our current challenges. Prime Minister Modi highlighted 2 issues, corruption and nepotism. Both resonate with the Indian voter. They also target the political opposition. The reference to corruption was aimed at parties like the Trinamool Congress or the TMC. It is the party in power in the state of West Bengal. And recently it made news for all the wrong reasons. Assets worth crores were seized from a TMC minister in West Bengal. The images are on your screen. As for nepotism, it is rampant in Indian politics across the board, but the target here is believed to be the Congress party that continues to be led by the Gandhi family.
जब मैं भाई भतीजावाद, परिवारवाद की बात करता हूं तो लोगों को लगता है मैं सिर्फ राजनीतिक क्षेत्र की बात करता हूं। जी नहीं, दुर्भाग्य से राजनीतिक क्षेत्र की उस बुराई ने हिंदुस्तान की हर संस्थाओं में परिवारवाद को पोषित कर दिया है।
So that was the Prime Minister's speech. Celebrations are still underway across the country. World leaders have sent their congratulations to India, from US President Joe Biden to British Prime Minister Boris Johnson, he's still Prime Minister, and Australian PM Anthony Albanese. Almost every world leader has cheered India's achievements. French President Emmanuel Macron shared a message in Hindi. He said India's achievements in the last 75 years have inspired the world. Vyond is now available in your country. Download the app now and get all the news on the move.
NatWest, tomorrow begins today.
आजादी के 75 वर्ष पूर्ण होने पर देशवासियों को अनेक अनेक शुभकामनाएं, बहुत बहुत बधाई। न सिर्फ हिंदुस्तान का हर कोना लेकिन दुनिया के हर कोने में आज किसी न किसी रूप में भारतीयों के द्वारा या भारत के प्रति अपार प्रेम रखने वालों के द्वारा विश्व के हर कोने में यह हमारा तिरंगा आन बान शान के साथ लहरा रहा है। मैं विश्व भर में फैले हुए भारत प्रेमियों को, भारतीयों को आजादी के इस अमृत महोत्सव की बहुत बहुत बधाई देता हूं। आज का ये दिवस ऐतिहासिक दिवस है, एक पुण्य पड़ाव, एक नई राह, एक नए संकल्प और नए सामर्थ्य के साथ कदम बढ़ाने का ये शुभ अवसर है। आजादी के जंग में गुलामी का पूरा कालखंड संघर्ष में बीता है। हिंदुस्तान का कोई कोना ऐसा नहीं था, कोई काल ऐसा नहीं था जब देशवासियों ने सैकड़ों सालों तक गुलामी के खिलाफ जंग न किया हो, जीवन न खपाया हो, यातनाएं न झेली हो, आहुति न दी हो। आज हम सब देशवासियों के लिए ऐसे हर महापुरुष को, हर त्यागी को, हर बलिदानी को नमन करने का अवसर है, उनका ऋण स्वीकार करने का अवसर है और उनका स्मरण करते हुए उनके सपनों को जल्द से जल्द पूरा करने का संकल्प लेने का भी अवसर है। हम सभी देशवासी कृतज्ञ हैं पूज्य बापू के, नेताजी सुभाष चंद्र बोस के, बाबा साहब अम्बेडकर के, वीर सावरकर के, जिन्होंने कर्तव्य पथ पर जीवन को खपा दिया। कर्तव्य पथ ही उनका जीवन पथ रहा। यह देश कृतज्ञ है मंगल पांडे, तात्या टोपे, भगत सिंह, सुखदेव, राजगुरु, चंद्रशेखर आजाद, अशफाकुल्लाह खान, राम प्रसाद बिस्मिल, अनगिनत ऐसे हमारे क्रांति वीरों ने अंग्रेजों की हुकूमत की नींव हिला दी। यह राष्ट्र कृतज्ञ है उन वीरांगनाओं के लिए, रानी लक्ष्मीबाई हो, जलकारी बाई, दुर्गा भाभी, रानी गायदिल्यो, रानी चेन्नम्मा, बेगम हजरत महल, वेलू नचियार, भारत की नारी शक्ति क्या होती है। भारत की नारी शक्ति का संकल्प क्या होता है, भारत की नारी त्याग और बलिदान की क्या पराकाष्ठा कर सकती है, वैसी अनगिनत वीरांगनाओं का स्मरण करते हुए हर हिंदुस्तानी गर्व से भर जाता है। आजादी का जंग भी लड़ने वाले और आजादी के बाद देश बनाने वाले भी, डॉक्टर राजेंद्र प्रसाद जी हो, नेहरू जी हो, सरदार वल्लभ भाई पटेल, श्यामा प्रसाद मुखर्जी, लाल बहादुर शास्त्री, दीनदयाल उपाध्याय, जयप्रकाश नारायण, राम मनोहर लोहिया, आचार्य विनोबा भावे, नानाजी देशमुख, सुब्रमण्यम भारती, अनगिनत ऐसे महापुरुषों को आज नमन करने का अवसर है। जब आजादी के जंग की चर्चा करते हैं तो हम उन जंगलों में जीने वाले हमारे आदिवासी समाज का भी गौरव करना हम नहीं भूल सकते। भगवान बिरसा मुंडा, सिद्धू कान्हू, अल्लूरी सीताराम राजू, गोविंद गुरु, अनगिनत नाम है जिन्होंने आजादी के आंदोलन की आवाज बनकर के दूर सुदूर जंगलों में भी, मेरे आदिवासी भाई बहनों में, माताओं में, युवकों में मातृभूमि के लिए जीने मरने की प्रेरणा जगाई। ये देश का सौभाग्य रहा है कि आजादी के जंग के कई रूप रहे हैं और उसमें एक रूप वो भी था जिसमें नारायण गुरु हो, स्वामी विवेकानंद हो, महर्षि अरविंदो हो, गुरुदेव रविन्द्रनाथ टैगोर हो, ऐसे अनेक महापुरुष हिंदुस्तान के हर कोने में, हर कान में भारत की चेतना को जगाते रहे, भारत को चेतनवंत बनाते रहे। अमृत महोत्सव के दौरान देश ने पूरे एक साल से हम देख रहे हैं, 2021 में दांडी यात्रा से प्रारंभ हुआ, स्मृति दिवस को संवरते हुए हिंदुस्तान के हर जिले में, हर कोने में देशवासियों ने आजादी के अमृत महोत्सव के लक्षावधि कार्यक्रम किए। शायद इतिहास में इतना विशाल, व्यापक, लंबा एक ही मकसद का उत्सव मनाया गया हो वो शायद पहली घटना हुई होगी। और हिंदुस्तान के हर कोने में उन सभी महापुरुषों को याद करने का प्रयास किया गया जिनको किसी न किसी कारणवश इतिहास में जगह न मिली या उनको भुला दिया गया था। आज देश ने खोज खोज करके हर कोने में ऐसे वीरों को, महापुरुषों को, त्यागियों को, बलिदानियों को, सत्याग्रहियों को याद किया, नमन किया। अमृत महोत्सव के दरमियान इन सभी महापुरुषों को नमन करने का अवसर रहा। कल 14 अगस्त को भारत ने विभाजन विभीषिका स्मृति दिवस भी बड़े भारी मन से, हृदय के गहरे गांवों को याद करते हुए, उन कोटि कोटि जनों ने बहुत कुछ सहन किया था, तिरंगे की शान के लिए सहन किया था, मातृभूमि की मिट्टी से मोहब्बत के कारण सहन किया था और धैर्य नहीं खोया था। भारत के प्रति प्रेम ने नई जिंदगी की शुरुआत करने का उनका संकल्प नमन करने योग्य, प्रेरणा पाने योग्य है। आज जब हम आजादी का अमृत महोत्सव मना रहे हैं, तो पिछले 75 साल में देश के लिए जीने मरने वाले, देश की सुरक्षा करने वाले, देश के संकल्पों को पूरा करने वाले, चाहे सेना के जवान हो, पुलिस के कर्मी हो, शासन में बैठे हुए ब्यूरोक्रेट्स हो, जनप्रतिनिधि हो, स्थानीय स्वराज की संस्थाओं के शासक प्रशासक रहे हो, राज्यों के शासक प्रशासक रहे हो, केंद्र के शासक प्रशासक रहे हो, 75 साल में इन सब के योगदान को भी आज स्मरण करने का अवसर है और देश के कोटि कोटि नागरिकों को भी जिन्होंने 75 साल अनेक प्रकार की कठिनाइयों के बीच भी देश को आगे बढ़ाने के लिए अपने से जो हो सका वो करने का प्रयास किया है। मेरे प्यारे देशवासियों, 75 साल की हमारी ये यात्रा अनेक उतार चढ़ाव से भरी हुई है। सुख दुख की छाया मंडराती रही है और इसके बीच भी हमारे देशवासियों ने उपलब्धियां की है, पुरुषार्थ किया है, हार नहीं मानी है, संकल्पों को ओझल नहीं होने दिया है। और इसलिए, और ये भी सच्चाई है कि सैकड़ों सालों के गुलामी के कालखंड ने भारत के मन को, भारत के मानवी की भावनाओं को गहरे गांव किए थे, गहरी चोटें पहुंचाई थी, लेकिन उसके भीतर एक जिद भी थी, एक जिजीविषा भी थी, एक जुनून भी था, एक जोम भी था और उसके कारण अभावों के बीच में भी, उपहास के बीच में भी, और जब आजादी का जंग अंतिम चरण में था तो देश को डराने के लिए, निराश करने के लिए, हताश करने के लिए सारे उपाय किए गए थे। अगर आजादी आई, अंग्रेज चले जाएंगे तो देश टूट जाएगा, बिखर जाएंगे, लोग अंदर अंदर लड़ करके मर जाएंगे, कुछ नहीं बचेगा, अंधकार युग में भारत चला जाएगा, न जाने क्या क्या आशंकाएं व्यक्त की गई थी। लेकिन उनको पता नहीं था ये हिंदुस्तान की मिट्टी है, इस मिट्टी में वो सामर्थ्य है जो शासकों से भी परे सामर्थ्य का एक अंतर प्रभार लेकर के जीता रहा है, सदियों तक जीता रहा है और उसी का परिणाम है हमने क्या कुछ नहीं झेला। कभी अन्न का संकट झेला, कभी युद्ध के शिकार हो गए, आतंकवाद ने डगर डगर चुनौतियां पैदा की, निर्दोष नागरिकों को मौत के घाट उतार दिया गया, छद्म युद्ध चलते रहे, प्राकृतिक आपदाएं आती रही, सफलता विफलता, आशा निराशा, न जाने कितने पड़ाव आए हैं, लेकिन इन पड़ाव के बीच भी भारत आगे बढ़ता रहा। भारत की विविधता जो औरों को भारत के लिए बोझ लगती थी, वो भारत की विविधता ही भारत की अमोल शक्ति है, शक्ति का एक अतुट प्रवाह है। और दुनिया को पता नहीं था कि भारत के पास एक इनहेरेंट सामर्थ्य है, एक संस्कार सरिता है, एक मन मस्तिष्क का विचारों का बंधन है, और वो है भारत लोकतंत्र की जननी है, मदर ऑफ डेमोक्रेसी है। और जिनके जहन में लोकतंत्र होता है, वे जब संकल्प करके चल पड़ते हैं, वो सामर्थ्य दुनिया की बड़ी बड़ी सल्तनतों के लिए भी संकट का काल लेकर के आती है। ये मदर ऑफ डेमोक्रेसी, ये लोकतंत्र की जननी हमारे भारत में सिद्ध कर दिया कि हमारे पास एक अनमोल सामर्थ्य है। मेरे प्यारे देशवासियों, 75 साल की यात्रा में आशाएं अपेक्षाएं उतार चढ़ाव सब कुछ के बीच में, हर एक के प्रयास से हम जहां तक पहुंच पाए थे पहुंचे थे। और 2014 में देशवासियों ने मुझे दायित्व दिया, आजादी के बाद जन्मा हुआ मैं पहला व्यक्ति था जिसको लाल किले से देशवासियों का गौरव गान करने का अवसर मिला था। लेकिन मेरे दिल में जो भी आप लोगों से सीखा हूं, जितना आप लोगों को जान पाया हूं मेरे देशवासियों, आपके सुख दुख को समझ पाया हूं, देश की आशा अपेक्षाओं के भीतर वो कौन सी आत्मा बसती है, उसको जितना मैं समझ पाया हूं, उसको लेकर के मैंने अपना पूरा कालखंड देश के उन लोगों को एम्पावर करने में खपाया। मेरे दलित हो, शोषित हो, पीड़ित हो, वंचित हो, आदिवासी हो, महिला हो, युवा हो, किसान हो, दिव्यांग हो, पूरब हो, पश्चिम हो, उत्तर हो, दक्षिण हो, समुद्र का तट हो, हिमालय की चंद्राएं हो, हर कोने में महात्मा गांधी का जो सपना था आखिरी इंसान की चिंता करने का, महात्मा गांधी जी की आकांक्षा थी अंतिम छोर पर बैठे हुए व्यक्ति को समर्थ बनाने की, मैंने अपने आप को उसके लिए समर्पित किया। और उन 8 साल का नतीजा, आज आजादी के इतने दशकों का अनुभव, आज 75 साल के बाद जब अमृत काल की ओर कदम रख रहे हैं, अमृत काल की ये पहली प्रभात है, तब मैं एक ऐसे सामर्थ्य को देख रहा हूं और जिससे मैं गौरव से भर जाता हूं। देशवासियों, मैं आज देश का सबसे बड़ा सौभाग्य ये देख रहा हूं कि भारत का जनमन आकांक्षी जनमन है, एस्पिरेशनल सोसाइटी किसी भी देश की बहुत बड़ी अमानत होती है। और हमें गर्व है कि आज हिंदुस्तान के हर कोने में, हर समाज के हर वर्ग में, हर तबके में आकांक्षाएं उफान पर है। देश का हर नागरिक चीजें बदलना चाहता है, बदलते देखना चाहता है, लेकिन इंतजार करने को तैयार नहीं है, अपनी आंखों के सामने देखना चाहता है, कर्तव्य से जुड़ करके करना चाहता है, वो गति चाहता है, वो प्रगति चाहता है। 75 साल में संजोए हुए सारे सपने अपने ही आंखों के सामने पूरा करने के लिए वो लालायित है, उत्साहित है, उतावला भी है। कुछ लोगों को इसके कारण संकट हो सकता है, क्योंकि जब एस्पिरेशनल सोसाइटी होती है तब सरकारों को भी तलवार की धार पर चलना पड़ता है, सरकारों को भी समय के साथ दौड़ना पड़ता है। और मुझे विश्वास है, चाहे केंद्र सरकार हो, राज्य सरकार हो, स्थानीय स्वराज की संस्थाएं हो, किसी भी प्रकार की शासन व्यवस्था क्यों न हो, हर किसी को इन एस्पिरेशनल सोसाइटी को एड्रेस करना पड़ेगा। उनकी आकांक्षाओं के लिए हम ज्यादा इंतजार नहीं कर सकते। हमारे इस एस्पिरेशनल सोसाइटी ने लंबे अरसे तक इंतजार किया है, लेकिन अब वो अपनी आने वाली पीढ़ी को इंतजार में जीने के लिए मजबूर करने को तैयार नहीं है। और इसलिए ये अमृत काल का पहली प्रभात हमें उस एस्पिरेशनल सोसाइटी की आकांक्षाओं को पूरा करने के लिए एक बहुत बड़ा सुनहरा अवसर देकर के आई है। मेरे प्यारे देशवासियों, हमने पिछले दिनों देखा है, एक और ताकत का हमने अनुभव किया है, और वो है भारत में एक सामूहिक चेतना का पुनर्जागरण हुआ है। एक सामूहिक चेतना का पुनर्जागरण आजादी के इतने संघर्ष में से जो अमृत था वो अब संजोया जा रहा है, संकलित हो रहा है, संकल्प में परिवर्तित हो रहा है, पुरुषार्थ की पराकाष्ठा जुड़ रही है और सिद्धि का मार्ग नजर आ रहा है। यह चेतना, मैं समझता हूं कि चेतना का जागरण ये पुनर्जागरण यह हमारी सबसे बड़ी अमानत है। और ये पुनर्जागरण देखिए, 10 अगस्त तक लोगों को पता तक नहीं होगा शायद कि देश के भीतर कौन सी ताकत है, लेकिन पिछले 3 दिन से जिस प्रकार से तिरंगे झंडे को लेकर के, तिरंगा की यात्रा लेकर के देश चल पड़ा है, बड़े बड़े सोशल साइंस के एक्सपर्ट्स ये भी शायद कल्पना नहीं कर सकते कि मेरे भीतर के अंदर कितने, मेरे देश के भीतर कितना बड़ा सामर्थ्य है, एक तिरंगे झंडे ने दिखा दिया है। यह पुनर्चेतना पुनर्जागरण का पल है। ये लोग समझ नहीं पाए हैं, जब देश जनता कर्फ्यू के लिए हिंदुस्तान का हर कोना निकल पड़ता है तब उस चेतना की अनुभूति है। जब देश ताली थाली बजा करके कोरोना वॉरियर के साथ कंधे से कंधा मिला करके खड़ा हो जाता है तब चेतना की अनुभूति होती है। जब दिया जला करके कोरोना वॉरियर की शुभकामना देने के लिए देश निकल पड़ता है तब उस चेतना की अनुभूति होती है। दुनिया कोरोना के कालखंड में वैक्सीन लेना या न लेना, वैक्सीन काम का है कि नहीं है, उस उलझन में जी रहा था। उस समय मेरे देश के गांव गरीब भी 200 करोड़ डोज दुनिया को चौंका देने वाला काम करके दिखा देते हैं। यही चेतना है, यही सामर्थ्य है। इस सामर्थ्य ने आज देश को एक नई ताकत दी है। मेरे प्यारे भाइयों बहनों, तीसरा एक महत्वपूर्ण सामर्थ्य मैं देख रहा हूं, जैसे एस्पिरेशनल सोसाइटी, जैसे पुनर्जागरण, वैसे ही आजादी के इतने दशकों के बाद पूरे विश्व का भारत की तरफ देखने का नजरिया बदल चुका है। विश्व भारत की तरफ गर्व से देख रहा है, अपेक्षा से देख रहा है। समस्याओं का समाधान भारत की धरती पर दुनिया खोजने लगी है दोस्तों। विश्व का ये बदलाव, विश्व की सोच में ये परिवर्तन 75 साल की हमारी अनुभव यात्रा का परिणाम है। हम जिस प्रकार से संकल्प लेकर चल पड़े हैं, दुनिया इसे देख रही है और आखिरकार विश्व भी उम्मीदें लेकर के जी रहा है। उम्मीदें पूरे करने का सामर्थ्य कहां पड़ा है वो उसे दिखने लगा है। मैं इसे स्त्री शक्ति के रूप में देखता हूं, तीन सामर्थ्य के रूप में देखता हूं, और ये त्रि शक्ति है एस्पिरेशन की, पुनर्जागरण की और विश्व की उम्मीदों की। और इसे पूरा करने के लिए हम जानते हैं दोस्तों, आज दुनिया में एक विश्वास जगने में मेरे देशवासियों की बहुत बड़ी भूमिका है।
With NatWest, tomorrow begins today.
वंदे मातरम। स्वाधीनता दिवस के पावन अवसर पर आप सभी को हार्दिक बधाई और शुभकामनाएं। हमारा 76वां स्वाधीनता दिवस और आज की ये सुबह मानो बधाई का संदेश लेकर आई है। दुनिया के सबसे बड़े लोकतंत्र ने 75 वर्ष पहले आजादी के पथ पर जो यात्रा प्रारंभ की थी, ये उसका महत्वपूर्ण पड़ाव है। आजादी के 75 वर्ष पूरे हुए हैं, यह आजादी का अमृत महोत्सव है और लोक कल्याण की गौरवशाली गाथा नई ऊंचाइयों को छू रही है। राष्ट्र की ओर से प्रधानमंत्री श्री नरेंद्र मोदी लाल किले की प्राचीर से 76वें स्वतंत्रता दिवस समारोह की अगुवाई करेंगे। वे यहां राष्ट्रीय ध्वज फहराएंगे और ध्वजारोहण के बाद प्रधानमंत्री राष्ट्र को संबोधित करेंगे।
Namaskar. As time gives birth to another day, as every passing day gives birth to history, and as every 15th of August gives birth to national celebration, joyous Independence Day greetings to every Indian blessed to inhabit this kaleidoscope of contrasts, cultures, and camaraderie we call India. As the nation comes together to celebrate its 76th Independence Day, let all eyes only see the tricolor, let all hands only rise in gratitude, and let all feet only tap to the beat of patriotism. As we complete this landmark year of celebrating our independence, it is the fragrance of reverence and respect that colors all festivities today. We bow our heads to those courageous men and women who fought for freedom in this land, our brave freedom fighters, warriors and role models, joining in from all parts of the country, scripting extraordinary stories and performing seemingly impossible tasks.
Aaj se 75 varsh pehle wo subha Bharat mein aayi thi, jiske liye Bharatvasiyon ne sapna dekha tha, sangharsh kiya tha, बलिदान दिया था। तब से आने वाली हर 15 अगस्त की सुबह में आजादी की भावना की वो महक होती है जो हर भारतवासी को गौरवान्वित करती है। आज 15 अगस्त 2022 की सुबह आजादी के अमृत महोत्सव की सुबह है। साल दर साल एक एक कदम शानदार और यादगार।
भारत ने इन तमाम वर्षों में एक देश के तौर पर जो हासिल किया है वो आश्चर्य से कम नहीं है। दुनिया का सबसे बड़ा लोकतंत्र एक शानदार देश है। संभावनाएं जहां संकल्प बनती हैं और सिद्ध हो जाती हैं, लोगों की जिंदगी कैसे बदलती है, हमने ये करके दिखाया है। देश जब आजाद हुआ तब हमारे सामने बहुत सारी चुनौतियां थीं। तब से अब तक के भारत की यात्रा कई मायनों में हैरान करने वाली है। पिछले कुछ वर्षों में राष्ट्रीय विकास और जन कल्याण के लिए किए गए उपायों और प्रयासों के सकारात्मक परिणाम हम सबके सामने हैं।
For India, the midnight between the 14th and 15th of August 1947 pushed open the gates of self-rule when a restless, eager and dynamic nation raised its face, lifted its fate and opened its arms to the winds of change. This historic Red Fort, marvelous, majestic and seemingly motionless, has witnessed and participated in all that change. Change that began with governance at the center, but would ultimately percolate down in social and real terms to towns and villages. Change that would bring with it ups and downs, churn and cheer, gloom and glory, but most importantly, change that would allow a free India to blossom and grow into a country that was unique and truly reflective of its people. It's a lovely cloudy day here in New Delhi. The sun peeking out to give that proverbial silver lining to every cloud. A slight wind making the national flag flutter with pride. Our freedom today gives us wings while our history anchors us to a land that has held us strong and gives us stability. Our strength lies in us being one, and that is what helped us get our freedom finally. When we all came together and public sentiment rode high on inspiring slogans like Swaraj is my birthright and I shall have it, Jai Hind, Vande Mataram, Simon go back, Inqilab Zindabad, Quit India. This nation we call our motherland has nourished, nurtured, and harbored us over the centuries. We salute this land, Vande Mataram.
Heera Dals, a vibrant range of beans and lentils for your kitchen. With dals ranging from chana to masoor, beans from butter beans, moong, red kidney and chickpeas. Heera Dals, take your pick today.
Shubhra Jyotsna Pulakita
वंदे मातरम केवल दो शब्द नहीं है, ये स्वयं में हमारे मान अभिमान और देश प्रेम को समेटे हैं। इसे आजादी की लड़ाई के लिए गाया गया और अब इसे देश के बढ़ते गौरव और इस देश की मिट्टी से हमारे प्रेम के लिए गाते हैं। प्रेम और उत्साह का संचार करता है वंदे मातरम। ऐतिहासिक लाल किला और उस पर शान से लहराता हमारा प्यारा राष्ट्रीय ध्वज, हमारा तिरंगा। और इसी लाल किले की भव्य दीवारों पर देश के अलग अलग राज्यों और केंद्र शासित प्रदेशों के प्रमुख स्वतंत्रता सेनानियों की प्रशस्तियों को सजाया गया है। The thing goes pop, 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 pop. इनमें उस प्रदेश की सांस्कृतिक, प्राकृतिक और धार्मिक विरासत को भी देखा जा सकता है। इन स्वतंत्रता सेनानियों को याद करते हुए हम सभी देशभक्तों के योगदान और बलिदान को आज याद कर रहे हैं। आज हर उस विभूति को देश याद कर रहा है जिनके प्रयासों से आजादी की लड़ाई को बल मिला और आखिरकार हम आजाद हुए। ऐसे बहुत से स्वतंत्रता सेनानी हैं जिनके बारे में कम जानकारी है या वे भी जो गुमनाम रह गए, उन सभी को सादर नमन।
बिफोर द डिजायर फॉर इंडिपेंडेंस बिकेम अ मूवमेंट, बिफोर इट गैदर्ड मोमेंटम, इट स्टार्टेड एज अ ड्रीम dreamt by thinkers, visionaries and leaders. It started as a song and a chant, Vande Mataram, inspiring people, stirring emotions and leading actions. It started as a sentence that became a mantra of thousands. Swaraj is my birthright and I shall have it. And in this saga of what went into making us today, who we are, some of the most inspiring stories are people who we have not read about. Silent revolutionaries, quiet workers and strong rebels, men and women who broke norms, challenged social constructs and led by example. Today, we salute all the sung and unsung heroes who gave patriotism true meaning. In fact, whenever we think of the independence movement, the bespectacled, calm and benign gaze of Mahatma Gandhi or Babu flashes across the mind. And we had so many other people, so many others who quietly gave their all.
Aaj ka din in sabhi naam anaam deshbhakton ko yaad karne ka vishesh din hai. लाल किले की दीवार पर तीन जगह इन प्रशस्तियों को सजाया गया है। आज ये कल्पना करना कितना कठिन है कि इन देशभक्तों को किन किन कुर्बानियों से गुजरना पड़ा। 200 साल की गुलामी थी, बहुत लंबा संघर्ष चला, लक्ष्य आसान नहीं था। कहा जाता है कि अंग्रेजों के राज में सूरज नहीं डूबता, पृथ्वी पर पूरब से पश्चिम तक उसके उपनिवेश थे, लेकिन इन देशभक्तों के बल पर भारत ने आजादी पाई और आज हम अपनी आजादी का अमृत महोत्सव मना रहे हैं। 75 वर्ष आजादी के पूरे हुए हैं और लाल किले की प्राचीर के सामने अलग अलग स्कूलों के 792 एनसीसी कैडेट्स मौजूद। इन कैडेट्स ने भारत के मानचित्र की भौगोलिक फॉर्मेशन में इसे रचा है। लाल किले की प्राचीर के सामने ज्ञान पथ।
Nearly 800 NCC cadets forming the map of India. From the snowy mountains, the beautiful mountain lakes and the peaceful regions of the northeast to the central and vibrant part of India. Color, culture, creativity, festivity are beautiful sand dunes, the somber sand color, and the gorgeous costumes.